Evening, everyone. Thank you for joining us for this special meeting of the Buncombe County Commission. I'd like to call the meeting to order. And we've got two purposes for the meeting this evening. One is to discuss the One Buncombe Fund and hold a public hearing to consider additional support for our community. And then following that, we're going to have our weekly COVID-19 update. So let's get started with the One Buncombe Fund, and Tim Love is going to get us started on this.
Good evening, commissioners.
Good evening.
Volume's louder than normal. So for this evening, just a quick presentation. This is the public hearing that's required for any economic development appropriations. We noticed it properly, and so we'll walk through this, but this is going to pick up where we left off last time with a discussion on One Buncombe. Additionally, Matt Raker with Mountain BizWorks may join us today. I think he's en route, so hopefully we'll see him. But if you have any specific questions, we can bring him up. So proceeding through the slides, let's make sure it's on. So our request today, so bottom line up front, two items for approval for the board. And as I speak of him, he appears, which is excellent. So Matt's here. So two items for a board approval this evening. The first is a resolution, and this resolution accomplishes a couple items. First, it would authorize $150,000in economic development appropriations, as well as the reinvestment of any funds received from One Buncombe through repayment back into the One Buncombe small business program. Additionally, that resolution authorizes the county manager or chairman to move forward with negotiations on the contract agreement with Mountain BizWorks to kind of finalize all this. So you're hitting a few items. Additionally, there is a budget amendment to move the money around, and Jennifer Barnett is here with us to walk us through that if we need to. In terms of the need, we talked about this last week, but it's important to kind of reiterate. Earlier last year, in March 2020, this board came together, kind of led the way with a number of our partners, including the City of Asheville, Dogwood Health Trust, others, and raised $1.4 million. That $1.4 million went into an individual assistance and small business program, which benefited over 1,000 individuals with just basic day-to-day expenses, rent, utilities, mortgages, things like that. Additionally, 95 small businesses were able to participate in a low-interest loan program, which helped us retain 685 jobs locally. If you remember at this point in time, we talked about this as a bridge program because there were no other programs. This was it locally. And so we were able to accomplish the goal of bridging to larger programs. A part of the good news is on the front of our businesses, many have been able to repay loans. And so that's a really exciting part of the story. These businesses are still around and able to pay their debts. Those funds have been taken and recirculated back into the One Buncombe program. However, there's a lot more work to do. And I think we knew this then and we knew it now. COVID was gonna be a long stretch for all of us, including our businesses. And we continue to see that in the numbers. You know, our unemployment rate is at 6%. The needs in our community continue to increase. So SNAP requests are up 24%. Medicaid requests up 7%. Last week in our presentation to you about economic impacts, we saw unemployment having a disparate impact on lots of different populations, but namely women who have specifically been hurt by this pandemic more so than others, as well as our minority populations. Further, our small businesses, they've depleted their reserves. They're doing what they can to hold on. Many have taken on tons of debt, and so really aren't seeking to take on more debt and are just trying to get through what is, for us, seasonally, a really slow time. So what do we do? On the individual assistance front, we talked at our last meeting about a great amount of support that is currently available to anyone that's listening to this program and how to get in touch if you have issues with rental assistance or anything like that. On the small business front, though, the picture's a little different, and we don't have as many supports in place, which is why we're talking to you this evening. So what's proposed to the board today for the public hearing is a small business grant program. And so this is a departure from some discussions we've had in the past about a small business loan program. We had sort of talked about, can we do a loan program and a grant program? And I've asked Matt Raker to join us today to talk about why that's potentially not a good idea. And the simple fact is, you know, we can do one thing or the other well. But trying to launch both a grant and a loan program at the same time, it spreads our resources, which are limited. So our recommendation to the board today is to proceed with a grant program, and I'm glad to talk through any of the details of that. We think that the grant program meets the need that is currently in our community, and that need has been documented well through survey data that Mountain BizWorks has collected through numerous programs that they've administered this year. So this grant program, at a high level, the goal would be to meet unmet needs. We're trying to fill the gaps. We're not trying to duplicate. So eligibility, off the top, small businesses that are impacted by COVID-19. The threshold that we're recommending for this is less than 25 employees. Our theory on this, and Matt can assist if y'all have questions, is that businesses greater than 25 employees are likely gonna get greater support through other avenues, namely the PPP. Additionally, we want to make sure that this grant very clearly ties to the retention or rehire of employees. That's the only way this works. We have to be able to directly show that we're impacting and keeping folks in the workforce in order to stay compliant with state statute. Additionally, we wanna make sure that those that are retained and rehired are done so at a living wage. And we've got some thoughts on that, but we'd like to reference the Just Economics numbers from 2020. Since the 2021 numbers just came out, we feel like we need to give businesses time to adapt to that. Additionally, it's hard for businesses to foresee the future, but we do think there needs to be a requirement to retain employees for some period of time. And so we're suggesting a 6-month retainage for these employees, just to know that these employees that are working for these businesses have some comfort in knowing that their jobs will still exist for some period of time. When we talk about focus areas, there's a lot, but we really want to cast a wide net with this. So if you're a small business, generally, you're going to be eligible for this program. Specific focus areas, though, so if you're ineligible for the PPP for any reason, you're in our bucket. We want to make sure that we're reaching out to you. A great example of some of those businesses are going to be our sole proprietorships, so we want to make sure that they're focused on with this grant program. Additionally, we want to make sure that we're recognizing the impact on minority-owned business and women-owned businesses. So these are specific focus areas that we're going to call out in this program. Our goal for this is to meet or exceed the targets that we hit with the last One Buncombe program. As a refresher, in our last round of One Buncombe funding, the $1.4 million, approximately 60% of the businesses that received loans were women-owned, and about 30% were minority-owned. So our goal would be to meet and exceed those targets through this program. The usage of the funds, I can't say it clearly enough. We want to support businesses, but we have to see a direct link to employment. So this has to link to the employment retainage of someone, keeping them in work. The model, again, a grant model, we're offering two tiers at this point based on our discussions with Mountain BizWorks. And those tiers are a $5,000 tier for businesses that have more than one employee, and then a $2,500 tier for businesses that are effectively of one, a sole proprietorship. So two tiers based on the number of employees that you're gonna impact. Again, the program would be administered by Mountain BizWorks, who's here with us today. So what I'd like to do is pause, see if you have any questions, in particular about the model for the program, and at that point, I'd love to have Matt sort of step up to the microphone and talk about any of those details. Any initial thoughts or questions?
I don't think so at this time.
Great. Matt, at any point, if there's anything you'd like to add to this, feel free. Maybe it'd be great to talk about the general needs.
Yeah, sure. Well, good evening. Thank you, Tim. I think Tim did a terrific job really setting this up. You know, in But first of all, I want to just thank the commission again and Buncombe County for your leadership in April of last year for really helping to rally support around One Buncombe and the formation of that. And it really was, the timeliness of that was so key in getting that bridge relief to businesses until some of the other federal programs and whatnot rolled out. And what we've seen right now is there's been a real dip in a number of those programs. A lot of the state programs ended at the end of the year, and at the same time, we're in the hardest months for a lot of small businesses to get through this. So there's a real need right now. So this is in a way, another really timely bridge to help get there. And we know that there is some PPP for certain businesses that's on the way, but that's gonna take some time to get here as well. I'll just share, in December, we surveyed a couple hundred local small businesses just to see where folks were, how concerned they were about their finances headed into Q1 of this year. And 2 out of 5 were moderately concerned, 2 out of 5 were very concerned. And so only 1 out of 5 felt pretty healthy about where they were going. So we know there's tremendous need out there. And I think one of the strengths of our approach here locally is having a number of different programs that's really tried to find something that meets the needs of most folks in one way or the other. So I think staff's really done a really nice job of putting this together and targeting it to where those needs are. And we'd be happy to help continue to administer it and answer any questions you might have.
Thanks, Matt.
All right. Thank you for that, Matt. And as additional questions arise, please feel free. Just a couple more slides to get us through, and then we'll put it to the board. So funding and sources. So if approved, the plan for staff would be to take the initial $200,000, which is comprised of $50,000 in repayments to One Buncombe, as well as $150,000 from this board. We would then like to go out and raise an additional $300,000 through our local partners, and those could be local governments, foundations, private entities, or the average person on the street. Partner pledges, you can see we have a section there. We've talked to a number of partners, and we know that some are currently considering, or will consider in the very near future, funding this program. One that I'd like to mention in particular is the Tourism Development Authority. They have a meeting tomorrow where they will be considering potential funding for this program through their earned revenues. So we'll see how that goes, but I wanted to call that out because they are considering this program. The target is $500,000, which, you know, if you think about it, that's 100 grants to small businesses, which could go a long way. We'll, of course, raise more money if we can, but we also want to be conscious that there's a lot of efforts in our community already to raise funds, and so we don't want to take the air out of the room as we're fundraising and making sure that those organizations get their opportunity as well. So assuming we move forward, how do I learn more? There's a couple websites on our screen. So on the left, to apply or learn more about the program, you'll go to Mountain BizWorks website, mountainbizworks.org/1BF, One Buncombe Fund. Try to keep it simple. And that's where you'll learn more about the program. The Mountain BizWorks team is updating this website as we speak, and after this vote, we'll launch the website with brand new information on it as we move forward. For those that are interested in making donations, on the right, you can go to onebuncombe.org, and the donation button is already active. I can attest to that because I've already given it a try. So that's where you can go for the One Buncombe donation site. Just to regroup on what the request was, again, asking for the Board of Commissioners approval for the resolution, which approves the $150,000, additionally allows the additional revenues to be moved into the grant program in the future, and allows the county manager or chair to negotiate with Mountain BizWorks on a contract agreement to move forward. Additionally, there's a budget amendment that also must be approved. And pending all of that, we would move into next steps. And so the next steps, press and community outreach begins now on this program, assuming it moves forward. Our application launch date would be February 10th, which is when folks would be able to apply for the funds. One of the things we've been struggling with a little bit is how quickly do we move? And so there's an administrative task here for Matt and his team, like how do they get ready? But there's also a task here that's really important in making sure that folks have access to the information so they can actually apply for this program. And so we want to give folks time from an equity and awareness standpoint to become familiar with the program, make sure that our outreach is hitting all the different parts of the county and not just those that are in the know and watch this program. So we're taking our time on outreach on the front end, and hopefully we'll be more equitable on the back end. In terms of targets, hopefully we would have money in bank accounts by the end of March. We'll of course try to move that up as quickly as possible, but that's our target at this point. So with that, I'll pause to see if you have any questions. If no questions, I would ask the chair to open the public hearing.
I have a question. I'm supportive of the grants, and I'm curious, because when we originally talked about this, we were thinking about loans too, so I'm just curious to hear why you've decided that it's better to focus only on grants.
That's great. So I'll ask Matt to join me for this, but part of it is choosing between one program or the other in terms of efficiency of launching a program, but I'll let Matt speak to some of the other details.
Yeah, when we looked at the funds, we think it's a good amount of relief, but it's still a relatively small fund if they were to split that in two programs. So just in terms of the administration and the communication, again, it would make sense just to focus at one. And if you gave people a choice, we'd have a sense of which one they would choose. Yeah.
All right, I don't see any other questions, so why don't we open the public hearing? So we will open the public hearing on consideration of this economic development investment at 5:18 p.m. Do we have any members of the public who are scheduled to comment? Mr. Joyner?
Yes, we do have one sign up.
Okay.
So we're getting the call set up.
I'm getting the call set up, so it should be up shortly.
All right.
Caller, you are live.
Hello, this is Don Yelton, and I understand I'm the only one that's addressed you fine commissioners today, but I'm standing out here in front of the office with signs that says open up restaurants. We can go to 50, why can't we go to 100? And I've read the proposal y'all are looking at, the $150,000, and I think $150,000 distributed among the businesses have been hurt. If you don't reach in your pocket and come up with a whole lot more, it's not going to be a whole lot. And bottom line is, I'm going to send a letter tomorrow to the county attorney, and I'm going to be requesting to see how much goes to the two nonprofits that this money is going to be funneled through before it gets to the end result, because I want to know where my dollars are going on the end and helping. And pardon the noise, that's a motorcycle going by. And that's my real comment and my real question, because I've got two other questions out there that have not been answered. And so I will address those in that letter to the attorney. So I want you to think about what I said very, very sternly, because if we can go to 50, why can't we go ahead and go to 100 and let people social distance and do what they should? And that brings up another point. We should be able to be up there and see your faces, and you see my face when we speak. I know this ain't going to do no good, but you're going to hear from me as long as you have to have public comment. Have a great one. Bye.
All right, thank you. Do we have any other folks who've signed up for public comment?
We don't have anybody
else. All right. I will close the public hearing at 5:20 p.m. So, commissioners, are there any other questions or comments? Or I think we need two motions, right? We need to approve the resolution, and then second, we need to approve a budget amendment. And the budget amendment is just for $150,000. The other $50,000 that's scheduled to be reinvested in this initiative has been previously invested in the One Buncombe Fund. It's loan proceeds that have come back. So do we need to speak to the $50,000 reinvestment or only $150,000 of additional investment?
So the budget amendment before you this evening is for the general fund for the appropriation from fund balance, $150,000. The $50,000 already exists within the Buncombe County Service Foundation because that's the arm in which managed and distributed the funds from the first, April 20. And so that money already exists, and those dollars are really kind of under the authority of the Service Foundation Board. So those exist, and the thought was is that if you acknowledge that those original funds that came from the county's general fund, that we would be allowed to repurpose those still in the Service Foundation.
Thank you. Commissioners?
Well, yes.
Mr. Presley?
Let me ask something here. As a small business owner, you're going to start awarding this the 15th of March. And with $50,000 already in there, I mean, January, February is a very tight month for some of these businesses. Are there any way, I mean, I can agree with the closing application, you know, or launching it on the 10th and closing it on the 1st, but somehow go ahead, use some of this money to help some of these people, because March 15th, I don't know if they can hang on that long, and like to see what we could do there.
Thank you for that, Commissioner, and we'll take that back for sure, because I think time is of the essence, and we'll see what we can do in terms of streamlining the process for sure, and we'll work on that.
I would just echo that comment. I understand the need for planning, and I understand we want to have an equitable pool of, like, we want to make sure, like you said, not just the folks who are already always tuned into everything have time to learn about it and prepare to apply, but my hunch is that word will get out about this rapidly, and we can all help with that. So if there is any way to move it up, I agree, like, this is the tough part of the year, so if there's any way to get ahead of that, that'd be great, but thanks for thinking about that. Other questions or comments? Is there a motion to approve the resolution?
Second.
All in favor, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? Is there a motion to approve the budget amendment?
So moved.
All in favor? Actually, hold on one moment. Before we do that, could we go back and actually, the person who spoke during public comment did have a question about kind of administration of the fund. So if Matt, if you could just speak to that, and you guys have been doing a great job on this, but I'd love for you to just kind of respond to that question.
Sure, yeah, you know, in the administration of the program, there's a number of things from the working with the partners on the communication, the outreach, and doing the education and the webinars, as well as receiving the applications, processing them all, reviewing them for compliance, entering into the individual grant award agreements in this case. There will be a follow-on just to ensure that the funds were used accordingly to the purposes, so a follow-on report, kind of performance report, for each of the recipients in this case. And so a number of administrative steps, not too dissimilar from what the approach was for the loan program as well in the process. And so we're looking at, I think what we've come out of when we looked at all the different efforts that will be in there is basically a 5% flat fee for the total fund size for the administration of the fund.
All right, thank you. Thank you for answering that. Okay. All in favor of the motion to approve the budget amendment, please say aye.
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 Any opposed? All right. Again, thank you to all the folks who have worked to pull this together. Thank you to Mountain BizWorks for partnering with us on this. And, you know, we just, as Tim Love said, we're really wanting this to be another community collaboration. We're happy for the county to be part of it. But that's part of what has made the One Buncombe Fund a real success is different folks coming together on this. So we just ask everybody, whether you're a local business, an individual, anybody who's in a position to contribute, we welcome working together to help folks through what's hopefully the last stages of this pandemic. But maybe it's in some ways some of the toughest parts of it. So, all right. Thank you very much, Tim. Is there anything else we need to do on this?
You're good.
Okay, all right. Very good. All right, now we will move to our COVID-19 update, and Stacy Saunders and Fletch Tove are here to help us with this.
Ready? So thank you all so much for the opportunity to briefly update you today on the COVID-19 situational report and a vaccine update. As of today's dashboard, around noon, we have identified 12,833 COVID-19 cases in Buncombe County. There have been a total of 247 COVID-related deaths as of today, and our new cases per day on average is roughly 112 per day, which is down from about 138 per day just 2 weeks ago. Our percent positivity continues to decrease since last week. Our current percent positivity today is 7.5%. That is the lowest that we've seen that percent positivity be since the holiday surge. So this is a very promising sign. The hospitalizations have seen a steady decline as well in the last couple of weeks, as you can see here by the region. And then just to quickly go over, overall the metrics that we follow are showing movement toward a more favorable, toward the more favorable areas. So please note that all the data that you're seeing here is actually from yesterday because we decided to do a Monday to Monday comparison. So our new cases per 100,000 per week is still higher than what we would want it to be, but has shown an almost 26% decrease since last week. As mentioned earlier, our percent positivity is now 7.5%. It has also decreased, seeing a drop of 1.1 percentage points since last week. So now we're seeing our percent positivity in a yellow range, which was far more favorable than what we were seeing just a couple of weeks ago. Our test per 100,000 continues to be high. That has been very consistent. It actually increased from last week. So last week it was around 3,500. This week we are seeing that over 3,700. COVID-19 related deaths per 100,000 also decreased this past week. And you can see that that decrease was almost 29%. Hospital data shows a slight decrease in the inpatient beds with COVID-19 and the ICU beds with COVID-19. And so just a reminder that the command center, we present this to command center each week, and we look for certain thresholds in order to recommend additional measures to you all. And those thresholds were 5 indicators in orange or red throughout the entire table, or 3 in orange or red in that upper tier. And as you can see here, currently we only have 2 red indicators, so no further measures are recommended at this time. Just wanted to continue to show you all the vaccine prioritization visual that we are currently in, still phase 1 and phase 2. Fletch is going to provide a more detailed vaccination operations update, but I wanted to share with you that as of the end of yesterday's clinics, Buncombe County Health and Human Services, with our partners at Emergency Management and other partners, have administered about 7,500 vaccines total since we started on December 22nd. About 90% of that is first dose administrations, and about the remaining portion of that is second dose administrations, which just started recently. We have about 2,000 doses from 2 Mission Health transfers that are going to be scheduled, that are scheduled already. So that 2,000 then goes into that total vaccine scheduled. So from today until Friday, there's 1,912 appointments scheduled. So we'll be using almost that entire allotment there. We received our notification on Friday that we will be receiving 975 doses either today or tomorrow. When I left the VAC site to come to the meeting, I had not received confirmation that we had gotten it yet, but we are expected to receive it today or tomorrow. I also wanted to quickly tell you all that the Secretary Cohen actually, at her briefing today, outlined new DHHS guidance with Tuesday, Wednesday shipments must be used by the following Monday. And so I'm going to go through that very quickly and just say that, as I mentioned, Secretary Cohen has released guidance today regarding vaccine allocations. Vaccine providers will be notified of baseline allocation for 3 weeks out. So that's a new development. We were finding out just week to week. So now we'll see a baseline that we can expect for at least 3 weeks. Vaccine providers will receive notification on Fridays, just as we have throughout the process, with shipment expected by the following Tuesday or Wednesday, and then all shipments received Tuesday or Wednesday must be used by the following Monday. So that new guidance that's coming out will require a slight change in our own clinics, which doesn't affect the total number of vaccine we're giving out, but the way we're going to do it, which is we are going to increase those numbers on Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Monday. No first doses on Tuesday, but still do our second doses on Tuesday, and then start back Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Monday for first doses, so that we are always getting that out Monday afternoon, and never carrying anything over to Tuesday. And as I said, Tuesdays will remain for second doses. At this time, I'll allow Fletch to come on up.
Good afternoon. So as part of our change in our vaccine operations, we opened up our second dose site this Monday, the 25th, at AC Reynolds High School. Do you want to thank all our partners, Emergency Services, the Buncombe County Schools, and helping us? That was a big lift for a week turnaround for a pretty major logistics operation. But we opened up at 8:30, started giving our second dose of vaccines there. And the current plan is continued through March 5th at Reynolds. We're assessing to see if we'll pivot to a second school that time or what other options we have. But that's our current intent. You can see some images from earlier this morning on the operations. You know, we did about 160 or so yesterday and 350 today. Those numbers are a reflection of what we did either 3 weeks or 4 weeks ago of Pfizer and Moderna, who became due today. That's how we determine those numbers. And those will continue to increase as we saw the increases at our first dose site. I do want to point out before I go to the next slide real quick is how great that site looks with all the tents and everything arranged. Because I want to talk about a vulnerability for our outdoor operations, and we're always vulnerable to weather. Last night, about 1 a.m, we had some sort of microburst that extremely damaged the site, knocked down all of our tents, moved some tents. You know, some of these tents weigh thousands of pounds of sliding them around the ground. But emergency services and fire departments rallied throughout the night to make sure we were able to open our operations at 8:30 on schedule, uninterrupted. So very grateful for that response. So we're gonna have to pivot a little bit to make these more sustainable for these outdoor operations. So we're looking at doing a one-for-one swap of tents to trailers. Mm-hmm. Trailers do a lot for us. They're gonna make those sites weatherproof. They'll be sustainable, you know, as we're doing this over months. And it's also modular. It allows us to get rid of our storage containers, and we'll be able to store equipment in the trailers themselves. And we do those transitions to different sites. It's as easy as just hooking those trailers to a truck and towing them exactly where we want. Also, if we have internal configuration changes at a current site, it makes it really easy for us to do that on our own instead of having to have massive equipment out.
Yeah.
So that's our plan going forward. I did have another slide I want to speak to quickly. What was it?
The equity slide?
I'll just go ahead and turn it over to Zoe. Thanks.
Okay, before you get off the slide and Zoe comes, I think what you're saying is what I ask you to pause. As Fletch mentioned this morning, or during the night, we had those microbursts to come up, and at 1 o'clock in the morning, and knowing that we could not postpone the 300 or so that we did today, emergency services and the sheriff's office that was on site, we did have deputies there to make sure it stayed safe. They got up in the night and they started making phone calls for us. So they were calling folks and getting people out of bed and had all hands on deck approach to get that site back up and running. Did we have a picture of what it looks like?
We do. I'll skip forward to it real quick.
Yeah. So I do want to take some time and ask you to join me in publicly thanking the employees mm-hmm. for the work they did last night. So I'll make the list while you're going to the new site. So if you see the 1 o'clock site and then the 9 o'clock this morning when we opened, it was back up and running again. So that would be Sheriff Miller and his team were on site, the Sheriff's Office deputies, the Fire Marshal's Office, Emergency Services led by Taylor Jones, Buncombe County, especially the West Buncombe Fire Department, City of Asheville Fire Department also came out, our Health and Human Service. You heard Fletch's voice is a little bit broken because he was out there as well this morning since 4 o'clock, and he's still here this afternoon. So I want to say thank you to Fletch for burning the candle at both ends. Public Health Director Stacy was also up. Stacy Saunders was up. And if you remember, she's only been here since less than six months, so it's right at the 6 month mark, giving much needed support and relief to Dr. Mullendore, who was carrying this since March. So thank you to Stacy for jumping in. I think she's done an amazing job to date. And one person that's been in the background from day one has been Stacy Wood. She is our public information officer for Health and Human Services. She's been consistent in this. She's the one that pulls all this data together, all these slides, and put it all out, and all the media talking points. So I do want to recognize all the staff and the efforts as they went through this past weekend. Sometimes it seems thankless what they're doing because they're always in the background, but I want to take the time to personally say thank you. I appreciate all you guys do, and I will ask if you would share some expressions of appreciation as well.
All right, let's give all these folks a round. Thank you for saying that, Avril. We really appreciate it.
And sure do.
All the different folks, you know, this is the kind of stuff that's going to get us through this. So right. we sincerely appreciate it. I know not just the board, but on behalf of the whole community. So thank you all very, very much.
Thank you.
I do have, I don't have this slide to go with it, but I did want to discuss one more thing today about VAX operations. Monday, we tested our capacity at AB Tech. We purposefully loaded that day to have a throughput of 850. What we found on site there is that with our staffing and processes, we definitely have the capacity to do 850 and more, but we did find out is that it becomes a footprint issue and spacing and safety issue just because of the space available to us there. So we think, you know, we also saw as we got to that number, we're having an average entry of the vaccination time of about 15 minutes or less. And we saw that number with that throughput go up to about 30 minutes, which is still great. But you know, just so we're aware of what that throughput does to customer service. But I think we've decided that around 750 or 800 is really what a sustainable throughput looks like for that site. That's without modifying hours. And then we can, as the weather gets nicer, we could potentially push some waiting area outside and you know tweak those numbers slightly. But I think that does revise what we're looking at for a daily sustainable throughput there, a little less than the anticipated 1,000 a day, more about 800 a day, which takes us back to that weekly output of 4,000 a week for that one site, which we can match at the vehicle site of 4,000 a week. And if you remember the presentation last week, so an output of 8,000 between those two sites, which I still think is substantial. I don't think we're expecting to see that level of vaccine in the near future. And it's another, I think that threshold is where we would really look to determine when we start transferring the community partners, when we start approaching those limits. With that, I'll turn it over to Zoe Mapofu.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.
I'm here to just give you a very high-level overview of the equitable approach and some of the concrete measures within that strategy for our vaccine operations to date. Beginning from this early summer, we stood up a Buncombe County COVID Health Equity Collaborative. This is a similar approach that we've taken to other ways in which we want to make sure that how we actually operationalize equity is something that is very much informed by the community, and so that was no different within our COVID operations. And so just to give you high level from an foundational or at least internal, we have been also added a equity division within our Emergency Operations Center. This equity division helps ensure that a lot of the components of our plans have some level of equity lens that we examine. We also have, and that particularly one of the best ways is within our communications. As you see here, we have the American Sign Language interpreters. That's an easy, concrete way. We also have been uplifting language justice. And so in the way that we have the simultaneous Spanish translation, that's another way that we've been advancing through our communications and outreach, is having that. We also have in this equity collaborative, community partners are helping to inform our approach so that we are in this place of building trust and restoration. So all of these community partners have also been really key in this early vaccine, in that some of them have been helping us identify those who are first 65 or 75 and older, and are Black, Indigenous, or persons of color, or just, as we would say, historically marginalized populations as well, to help them with being clear on where the vaccines are and how they might be able, and supporting them in that registration process. We have lots more to go, and we have lots more innovations. And one of those others is identifying or supporting through Mountain Mobility the transportation hurdle. We know that transportation is one of the four health and human services social determinants of health priorities. And so we're lucky to be able to have Mountain Mobility, and they'll be supporting connecting people to transportation to vaccines and as another concrete measure of equity. And tomorrow for communications, we are continuing our Let's Talk COVID series, and tomorrow we begin a two-part conversation on the vaccine. What's unique about this time is that we're partnering with the YWCA, who has been a local champion of social justice, and also in this national year, they are focusing on racism as a public health crisis. They're happy to be a partner, and we're looking forward to that conversation as we unpack some of the painful truths that very much inform some of our community members' questions about, is the vaccine right for them? So we're excited to be able to bridge any of that healing that needs to happen, and hopefully to move forward in many people deciding that, yes, the vaccine is the right choice for me and my family. So thank you all. Stacy will be coming up now.
Great, thank you, sir.
So we just wanted to wrap it up with just a reminder of how the wait list works. You all are familiar that we launched that. And just to remind our community that you can call or visit our website to get on the wait list. You can call 828-250-5000. Or you can visit buncombecounty.org to fill out your own waitlist application. Once you're added, you'll receive a notification and a confirmation number that could take up to 48 hours. You'll receive a call from our call team at 828. They'll be calling from 828-419-0095 to schedule your appointment. If you don't answer the call after the second call, You maintain your spot the first two times, and then you get moved to the bottom of the list. And then once the ready team completes scheduling available appointments, they'll go through the list and attempt a third and fourth call for those who they weren't able to reach. So just a reminder for folks that the wait list is out there, currently open for phase one and phase two.
Stacy, I have a question about that. So when you do the calls to them, are they able to call you back? Because that's some of the feedback I'm getting. They're confused about that. So you call, they don't answer. Are they able to call back?
So we've had some folks call back. Mm-hmm. If the appointments are still available, then we've been able to schedule them too. But typically, by the time they call back, the schedule is totally booked by that time. But they keep their spot in line for the next time we open those appointments. So they'll still be at the top of that list then.
Okay, so they do have to answer that call.
They do need to answer that call. It's super important.
Okay, thank you.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yes, thank you. Thanks for the reminder, Fletch. We were getting some reports from folks, one report that they had to give their Social Security number. We don't ask for that, so just be sure that when we're calling you, we're not going to ask for your Social Security just to get you on the wait list. There's a consent form when it's time for your appointment that's going to ask you for lots of information, but not at the time of putting you on the wait list. So we just wanted to remind folks that you do not have to provide that. I'm sorry.
Or payment.
Yeah, and no payment information either. Thank you for the reminder.
One other kind of process question. My understanding is that, and I'm not exactly sure where this comes from, the CDC or maybe some other agency, and then the North Carolina Department of Health and Human Services, but the main kind of philosophy around kind of national and statewide vaccinations is that political boundaries should not be a determination of how the programs are administered, right? Like, we're going to have lots of local governments and others across the country doing this, so they would not be restricted to only administering them to residents of their jurisdiction. So I'm sure other people get questions about this too, but I just wanted to ask you to just sort of clarify what the policy is.
Sure. That's correct. Because this is a federal administered program, meaning federal dollars went into the purchase of the vaccine, we cannot limit by jurisdiction.
Mm-hmm.
So if you live and work, like if you live in one county but work in another, so if you live in another county but work here in Buncombe, mm-hmm. those county lines don't matter.
Right.
And so there's clear documentation in that DHHS has provided to us as well to be sure that health departments and other vaccine providers understand that because it's a federally supported program, that jurisdictions, mm-hmm. Those county lines don't matter.
And is it your sense that most mm-hmm. most places are kind of playing by those rules? In our region, you know, we hear people say so and so place doesn't do that, but are most communities or in counties adhering to that recommendation?
I believe so. That's been my experience,
right,
particularly out here in the West. Okay. But I haven't heard any egregious sort of behaviors outside of our region either.
So while some people from outside Buncombe County will get vaccinated in Buncombe County, some people in Buncombe County will also get vaccinated in other counties. So
that's
at the
correct.
End of the day, it's that's the approach, and it should all work out well for everyone as the supply.
And vice versa, right? That
yeah.
There will be some folks who don't live in Buncombe County that will likely get vaccinated here as well.
Sure.
So.
Okay, thank you for clarifying that. Commissioners, any other questions?
I had one about, I have a couple questions, but I guess I'll start with no-shows. I guess, and how you handle that. I think I understand it, but for the sake of the public, I assume you certainly want people to show up, but I guess describe to us what citizens should do if they can't make it, how to notify you, and then also what happens if someone doesn't show up and what happens to that vaccine.
So I will first say that early on in this vaccine rollout, there are very few no-shows.
Yeah.
folks are showing up. If we do encounter a no-show, you know, it's great if you can notify us, but it's not absolutely necessary to do so. So if at the end of the day we've had a no-show, that's one of those doses that we reach out to folks that are within those phases and get somebody there. Mm-hmm. Wasting a dose is not an option. So we work really hard that if we have medical first responders or healthcare workers or those who are over 65, that we can pull in very quickly, then we get them vaccinated. So not to waste. But no-show rates right now are pretty low.
Awesome. And a second totally unrelated question. I read your letter on behalf of the Local Health Directors Association, which was super helpful and informative. But I guess I just want to ask generally about the impact of the mass vaccination sites across the state. It's been in a lot of newspapers, not really locally, and hearing about other counties, you know, canceling their appointments for the entire month of February, for example, I've heard. And I guess I'm just curious why that doesn't seem to have impacted us, and do you have any reason to expect that it would in the future?
So thanks for the question. I've been very careful to make sure that in this capacity I am your health director, but I appreciate the question and just will say that there was a desire to make sure that we as a state got rid of the backlog of vaccine that was in the state for first doses. There was a ramp up that that occurred, that it also included transfer of doses, and it was very successful. I'm not sure if you were able to hear Secretary Cohen's briefing today, but we're at about 90%, 90 or 95% of getting rid of our first doses now. Commitments were made by the state for other mass vaccination sites during this, you know, into this week as well, and that resulted in some jurisdictions, or I should say some vaccine providers of all sorts, getting less or no vaccine. And so, you know, it's been a really, really great opportunity to be able to voice not only the concerns of local health departments, but our other partners in this too have voiced their concerns and had really good dialogue with the state. And if you didn't hear today, the secretary outlined that that new guidance to help us have a little bit more consistency, a little bit more notification, better communication. And so I will say that, you know, it's been really, it's been great to sort of know that the voice of health departments has been heard and our other partners have been heard as well, and that I look forward to being able to, you know, operationalize that guidance. But some of that vaccine was sent to larger sites to be able to push it out very quickly. Okay. We did not see a decrease. We got our standard shipment of 975.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I haven't followed this maybe story as quite as closely. Heard a bit about it. Are those mass sites going to continue, or is that sort of done, and now it's going to be kind of like, you know, distributed statewide and kind of more?
I don't have any additional information about the continuation of those large sites. I do know that Secretary Cohen did release more information today about future allocations to the state being divided up by the bulk of it going out equitably to jurisdictions within the state, and then a small portion of that being held for targeted or focused distribution for historically marginalized populations or other mm-hmm. types of that work.
And they understand, I mean, the concern about not getting the vaccines in the state administered, that's of course totally valid. We all want that. But of course, you know, we have the capacity to administer many times the amount that we're actually receiving too. So does the state understand that there is a way that just getting it out to the counties rather than dumping them all in one site is another viable pathway to getting a lot more vaccines administered?
Yes, I think so. It was acknowledged today that not just health departments, but other vaccine providers really did ramp up their capacity, mm-hmm. did show that they could push a lot through, and now we're back at our regular allocation. So that what the state called a backlog was, I think, almost 300,000. It was around 280-some thousand. So folks were able to push that out very quickly, increase their capacity. But after that, we went back to our standard 120,000 allocation for the state. And so now all of that ramping up, we'll see that, and we'll see that as, you know, a 975, so 1,000 doses to be scheduled out versus what we were seeing before, which was about 3,000. And so we are still hopeful that our hospital partners, if they have vaccine available, that we can work on transfers that mm-hmm. way. But we did not receive a Western North Carolina collaborative bump this week.
Okay. Well, thank you for advocating for us.
I just want to make sure you heard what Stacy said, how many vaccines the state is getting. Mm-hmm. As a whole state, it's only 125,000 for the entire state of North Carolina. So it's kind of hard.
Yeah.
When you hear that number and how many millions of people live in North Carolina.
10 million.
Yeah. You understand we're not getting, as a state, we're not getting that vaccine quantity.
Well, sure. Agreed. But hopefully as that improves, you know, I mean, because the amount we're getting right now is, I mean, we appreciate the excellent work everyone's doing, but for a population of ours, more than 250,000, it's pitiful. I mean, it would take over a year to do this, so, or more than that. So. Thank you for your advocacy for that on behalf of our community, and just for good policy for the whole state, for counties across the state. Any other questions, commissioners? All right. Thank you so much, Stacy. Appreciate you. Avril, do we have anything else we need to attend to? Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
All in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
We're adjourned.